Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, this is the last episode of the Dan and Kody podcast this year. It's Christmas. We're going out with a bang. So let's go. Episode 196.
This is the Dan and Kody podcast.
Guys, welcome to the podcast. No Kody this week, but my good friend, my partner in crime, John Densmore is here. We went to college together at Frostburg. He is a Steadicam operator here in Los Angeles. Credits Fox Sports, NBC Sports, NFL Network, Nat Geo. John's in the building.
Oh, you put up my IMDb.
What's up, buddy? Yeah, man, I got to do my research.
Jeez, I should have sent you my little cover letter, my demo reel.
Yeah.
Could have had you as an agent.
You should have. I just Googled you.
I appreciate
you're Googleable.
That. Ah, but do you know the other John Densmore then if you Googled me?
Yeah, he died.
No.
There was a John Densmore in L.A.
That's fake news.
Yeah, man.
No, John Densmore is a drummer of the Doors.
Oh, he is?
Yeah, so every now and then I get a diehard fan that comes up to me and goes, are you his son?
For real?
Oh, for real. And depending on, you know, obviously if the guy is, you know, cool or not, I'd be like, yeah, I'm definitely his son. Or, you know, when I was in Santa Monica, we got a couple calls and mail from insurance people about it. You know?
About John Densmore?
Yeah, yeah. So apparently I think he lives in Malibu or something like that.
Yeah, he's the first Googleable result.
Right.
John Densmore tours the old Door sites.
But after this podcast, I will be the number one search after that.
Yeah.
I will pop up.
If you Google John Densmore camera, you're number one. You are number one.
Wonderful.
I got you on Mandy.com.
Oh, jeez.
I didn't know if that was like a dating site or not. It's like, who's Mandy?
Dude, when I moved out to LA, I signed up for everything to get jobs. You know, that's what you got to do.
What's Mandy?
Mandy's just a job board site for industry people. For TV jobs, film jobs, really anything for free. Like Craigslist, if you will. You know?
Okay.
Yeah.
But I guess LinkedIn's like the best.
LinkedIn's really turned themselves around as far as, with that. But LinkedIn at the time, I would say even 3 years ago, really wasn't for industry people.
Right.
You know? Especially freelancers.
It's social work Facebook.
Right. Correct. That's totally, you're right.
Stay away from it.
Yeah, of course. Well, you have a full-time job. That's why. And you're safe there.
But like, can you like... I'm safe there.
You are.
I hope, man. I'm always nervous about. Yeah. I always think I'm like, I'm gonna get fired today.
No,
but I think that keeps me like good.
Yeah, you're good people, man.
That makes me want to do well.
Exactly.
It's just always a fear of being fired. Live your life like you're about to get fired.
Hey, that's a freelancer's life right there. Every day, man. Like I just did the Chargers Minnesota game on Sunday.
Right.
And, you know, who knows? That could have been my last NFL game. You know, you don't know. I mean, I hit it off with the director, but you never know.
Yeah. It's fun, though.
It's very fun.
It's different every day.
Every day is something different. Exactly. I'm going into somewhere new experiences, work with new people.
Yep.
So I like that. And a little fun story, a little side note from that Chargers game. We get on camera about 2 hours before the game starts just to get like player warm-ups, any side stories happening. And I just jumped on and I pointed my camera and I see this guy proposing to a girl.
Oh shit.
Yes. And you know, the director and producers loved it. Like, oh my God, get her, you know, like, let's find out.
Did she say yes?
She did say yes. It was a Chargers fan proposing to a Minnesota Vikings fan.
What?
Yeah, so that was even
better.
So
the girl was a Vikings fan?
Correct, yes. And she had her family there. They had a big banner sign that said she said yes. So that was already pre-made. They had this big banner that said she said yes.
Do you think they staged it?
Well, I mean, obviously the family's got to be in it, right?
Right.
They got to be in the story.
Well, yeah, the family's got to be in on it.
Yeah, in on it.
But do you think that they were already engaged? And they were like, we're going to get on TV.
No, because it happened. It was really, I was the only guy that shot that. So it was like, nobody told us about it. You know, I just happened to find them and he got down on one knee. I mean,
At StubHub.
At Dignity Health now it's called.
Oh, really?
It's called Dignity Health, yeah.
That's how long I've been not a season ticket holder.
I think it just was this year they did it, but yeah. But yeah, so they actually used it in the story during the game, of course, when the Vikings were blowing out the Chargers. You know, the game
they were like,
whatever,
give us any kind of footage
content. So they were like, let's run the engagement story.
Yeah.
And our female, the sideline reporter, went up to them during the proposal afterwards and got their seat location. So we did a little segment about it. So there's little things.
That's,
you know,
fun.
Yeah. They're, instead of just shooting the game, you're telling other stories, you know?
Yeah. So how much footage would you say do you have of just like weird things happening in the stands? Like, what do you get to see?
Oh,
like, guys picking their noses,
yes,
scratching,
yes,
their,
yes,
balls.
Well, the first thing that really comes to mind is Dodger Stadium.
Right.
Dodgers baseball, right?
You work Dodger Stadium too.
Yes.
Right.
Yes, yes. And I do mainly the in-house video. In-house meaning the video board content, you know, stuff for the fans only in the stadium, not for people at home.
Right.
However, some of the stuff that I've done there has gone viral. And
oh, right, Granny.
Granny, Flashing Granny.
Yes, I love Flashing Granny.
I found her, too, on the Robo cams. I was doing Robo that day.
So take us through Flashing Granny.
Flashing Granny, well, you know, part of the in-house is, you know, you want to entertain the crowd there. So you're looking for people that are entertaining, that look different, that, you know, look just like having a good time. And I saw this older lady, and she was dancing during an inning break, you know, just for a casual fan cam on the Jumbotron.
Right.
Video board. And I was like, you know what? She's pretty good. And I got her up. I pointed the camera to her. I said to our director, hey, you know, got a good one on Robo. He took it. She did a little dance. It was great. People loved it. We went off of that, got some more fans, and then came back to her because she was still, you know, dancing away. And she just, when we caught back to her on the screen, everybody was screaming and hollering for her, and she loved it. Next thing you know, she pulls her top up.
Oh, my God. Yeah, if you Google Flashing Granny Dodgers, you'll get right to it. And she's having the time of her life.
She's got a really good
God
story,
bless
which
her.
Also helps sell it after the fact. She did a little media tour around LA. She had a story written about her late husband that passed away and how she lives life to the fullest. You know, she really does have a good story, and God bless her. She also, you know, marketed it. She had t-shirts made up. I saw her the next season. I ran into her and I told her I was the guy that, you know, found her on camera. And you know,
she's like, you've changed my life, Sonny.
She, you know, it was so funny though. She has, you know, t-shirts of herself made up that says Flashing Granny on it. You know, she's great.
You got to get your 15. You got to get your minutes. Find it. Strike when the iron's hot.
Yep.
Sell that merch.
Yep.
Get your grams up.
Yep, exactly.
And
she's
start to kill it.
She's hip. Now, you're a big sports guy, Dan. So, like, when you go to a sporting event, any venue, like, what are you there for? What are you there to see?
I'm there for the game, and I'm there for the food, and I'm there for the merch.
Really?
Love merch.
But see, the merch
Love
is
the
so
free.
Marked up, though.
I like, well, no, like the giveaway merch.
Ah, the freebies.
Like bobbleheads, towels,
yeah.
The little fingers that say number one,
okay.
the shirt with the sponsor on the back.
Gotcha.
Sign up for 17 credit cards, get a t-shirt. Or like some weird hat I'm never going to wear. That's my jam.
But see, now what you're hurting my feelings about now is you're not saying about you want to be there to be entertained.
Well, I want to, and I love weird kiss cams.
Ah.
And I love the, cam. I love the dance offs. I'm over.
Flex cam.
Yeah, I'm over.
The emoji cam.
What sucks here's what sucks about dance cam.
Yeah.
Dance cam sucks because kids jump all up in it and all they do is jump.
Yeah. And they do the flossing.
Yeah.
You know, they're all about the floss.
But I don't love plants. Like you see all these viral dance cam videos, and the people are fake.
Yes, yes, yes.
And there's fake kiss cams.
We used
too.
To do that at Nationals during the Nats game. We would do that.
You would have a fake like a plant that you would go to.
Yeah, because also with the Nationals at the time were horrible. When I was working with them back in like 2009.
Yeah.
And now they're won the World Series, but at the
time, right.
So you got to do anything you can. But Dodger Stadium though, like you're not there, you know, you're there for the game to walk around and smell the the ballparks,
yeah,
the friends, the Dodger dogs.
I have a Dodger dog record of like 9, a prop store record.
Oh my gosh.
I crushed like 9 Dodger dogs in the all you can eat section. But I mean, I'm there to enjoy it.
Yeah.
Baseball is interesting because I'm really not there to watch the game.
Mm-hmm.
It's eat, consume,
chat with your friends.
Chat. Yeah. You barely watch. You watch like the last couple innings.
Yeah.
You know? But that's baseball though. Basketball, I'm there to watch, take it in. And I don't know. Does baseball even have a halftime show?
Yeah.
Really? Well,
seventh inning stretch, yeah. And then basically every break, you know, is sponsorships
there's
and
something.
Stuff. But things really, Dodger Stadium is really unique to me in the sense of venues because I guess we've kind of, I hate to say, trained the audience or trained the crowd, but like they love the video boards and they're hard to miss. There's 2 of them. It's really
right.
Something special because each board can be controlled independently. So you can have like 2 different replay angles on there. Or like you can show 1 camera and then another camera. So
right.
In that sense, it's an amazing, amazing thing to do because you can have like a dance off and actually put the 2 guys up there. You don't have to do split. I mean, obviously there's split screen.
Yeah.
Sorry for the audience if we're getting too in the weeds for this, but
dude, the dance off is great.
Yeah. Kiss cam. There's a little science behind kiss cam. If I can tell
yeah.
the secrets behind that.
Hell yeah. I want to know the secrets behind kiss cam. You kidding me?
So, you know, as you know, camera, you want to entertain the crowd. So what I tend to do is try to find couples together, mixed matches, like 2 girls together, or 2 guys together that are, you know, if there's a guy, girl, but you know that the guy and the girl in the center aren't really, they're not together really, you know, they're with the people next to them. And there's been times where I've known that because you can, you know, when you're filming them.
You're like watching. You're lurking.
Yes. Yeah. Because it's all about, you know, entertainment. You got to find the best people, you know?
Yeah.
And so, you know, I will just frame those 2 couples in there, the guy and the girl, knowing mm-hmm. that they're not really together. So when they get on, when we take them live, they look at each other like, oh, we're not, I'm with that. And then, you know, the crowd loves it.
Yeah.
They
get
go
all bashful.
Yeah. Or you get the old lady next to a young kid, you know,
that sort
of thing. So you do kind of set some scenes up.
And the great one is when you put an away player
yes.
with another away with
yes.
the other team.
Yes.
And try to get them to kiss.
See,
it's great.
That's exactly what we're going for.
That's a good one.
That's entertainment.
There. But what are the other like staged ones? I saw one where like, the guy like wouldn't kiss
yeah.
Cam's girl, and then like the mascot comes and like beats him up,
or he does a beer, he kisses yeah. his beer, you know, that sort of thing. Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. I love a good like one handed grab by a fan of a foul ball.
Yes, yeah.
And then they like chug their beer or something,
yep.
or they catch it weird. That one dude got super famous because he wouldn't drop his Bud Lights at the Nats game, the World Series.
Wow.
I missed that one. He was like, yeah, this guy was like holding 2 beers
uh-huh.
and like a home run was coming or a foul ball and he like caught it in his arm, but kept the beers.
That is impressive.
And everyone was like, holy shit. They freaked out on him. And then I think Bud like they just got everything behind him.
That's better than trying to hold a baby. You're holding your son or daughter and then you catch one. It's like, I'm not getting anything for free for holding my
right,
kid. Shoot,
right.
Some beer then next time. All right.
Yeah.
I see where you're headed.
So you're telling the stories, man. And the other one that is great is when you have to like find the ball in the 3 hats.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And
yeah.
you have to like pick it. Yeah.
Yep.
Love
that's
that
always,
shit.
That's always a good one.
Yeah.
Kids steal the bases. They stopped doing that because a couple of the kids wiped out and they were crying.
Ooh.
Yeah, they would steal the base and they're running with the base, but of course the base is a little too heavy for them and they trip and fall in front of everybody and we get it in slow motion too, you know? And
yeah.
I think they did away with that promotion or that game because it was just, yeah, it was too sketchy.
Kids are getting hurt, man.
You don't want to see tears.
No, or lawsuits.
Or lawsuits. other fun stuff is you do see fights happening in the outfield and of course being in-house, you know, we have to cover the game, but we can also, you know, find the fans. So it's like once a fight happens, whoop, you turn our cameras right there.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then security wants our footage too, you know, so that's.
Oh, to see who started
see
it.
You know, see the details because we normally get there after the fact, but.
Right.
Yeah, so that kind of happens too.
Is it true that keg beer in stadiums is more watered down? than a regular keg beer.
Well, seeing how that I'm working and I'm not supposed to be drinking beer, but as a fan, when I do go as a fan sometimes.
And I got to pee way more.
You're right, though. Carbonation, maybe it's more carbonated. Right.
It tastes lighter, mm-hmm. and I definitely have to pee way more.
I think you're onto something with that. I think so. There's probably no quality control with that either. They're just tapping in and just adding a little bit of a water source to it.
Right. And they're like, well, this is game beer.
Yeah.
So fuck those guys.
I could see that.
But that's why I started buying cans at games now.
Cans. All right. Yeah, you can't go wrong with that.
Yeah, I'll get like a 12, tall boy. Yeah. $19 tall beer.
Yep. Yep.
God damn it. So, last week, we always do a recap, John.
Oh, the recap, yes.
Yeah, always do a recap of the episode before. And we ask people to chime in every week, give us an Instagram, audio, DM. Most people don't do it. But this week, we cried a little bit last week, so now we got some messages back. But the last podcast, we talked about the art banana. Did you hear about that story?
No, I did not.
There was this artistic display down in Miami, and it was just a canvas with a fucking banana on it. And then it got taped over, and then somebody ate it. That was cool. We talked about Catherine O'Hara being a bad mother in Home Alone. Mm-hmm. I know Rebecca didn't like that too much.
My wife Rebecca had something to say. I had something to say about that too. You're right. I was like, you should have included the dad in that. But for question purposes alone, I do understand your question now.
Jenny was pissed about it. Yep. Got a lot of heat
topic,
about
man.
It.
Especially as parents now, you know, I get it.
I'll concede. Yes, they're co-parents. So he has some of the blame. But
your question alone was just, is she a bad mother?
Yeah. Yes, she is definitely. But I get what people are saying.
Yeah.
Maybe he is a little bit. Then we talked about that, the James Harden dunk. Mm-hmm. Did you see that?
Yes.
Where like the basketball went out.
The refs blew it for sure.
Blew it.
Crazy.
Totally blew it. Then we talked about this close call at a school, Mountain View school. Where this guy was just, quote unquote, lurking in a hooded cloak outside the school. And like
cosplay?
No, just like chilling, trench coat. Mm. And then all these parents like called the cops.
Good.
And then the cops came and just took him away, questioned him.
Yeah, but what happened?
He was just there.
He was just there.
Yeah, that's like the end of the story.
Creepers are going to creep.
Creepers going to creep, but they got a right to take him away. Now, we got a message on Instagram. I'm going to play for you guys from, I know you know, Mr. Dave Knight.
Oh, Dave Knight.
So let me cue that up for you.
Philadelphia Eagles fan.
Yes, sir. They just kicked the shit out of the Redskins.
Hey, Dan. Hey, Cody. This is Dave. I just wanted to comment a little bit on that podcast where you were talking about Elf on the Shelf. I made my way down here to the South Pole. I wanted to see and kind of check on Snowball after Jenny brutally murdered him. right now, he's kind of stuck in Elf Purgatory where Jenny sent Snowball. I think it was circa 2014, Dan, that Christmas when she touched him from the Christmas tree. I mean, the poor guy's down here. If you can hear with the chaos going on, he's boiling in a cast iron caldron full of hot cocoa, kind of while being castrated by candy canes, razor sharp candy canes. So I really hope Jenny's happy. Our kids are pretty mortified and elf deprived. Right now I'm in Christmas hell. All right, take care, guys.
Wow, he is in purgatory. I can tell.
Jesus. Yeah, so Jenny's, thanks for that call, Dave. I hope everything works out with your elf. But Jenny, several years ago, we went over to their house on like Christmas Eve or whatever, mm-hmm. and their son, little David, was playing Simon Says with Jenny. Jenny didn't know the rules of Elf on the Shelf, and little David was like, Simon Says, get Snowball. So Jenny just walks over, plucks the elf, and then Dave's little boy's face like he was totally freaked out.
He ruined Christmas.
Out.
He ruined it.
She ruined Christmas. She touched the elf and the magic flew out of his heart forever. Well, so thanks for that call, Dave. Now we've got one.
Yeah, Dan's elf in the shelf right now is hanging on to a liquor bottle, it looks
That's right. Pouring a little glass, a little solo cup glass.
Mama's juice.
Now we've got one from Tony, I believe.
Tony. Tony from Jersey.
Oh, no. Ian. Ian's back. All right, let's play this one.
What's up, boys? It's Ian. Just wanted to let you guys know that I'm safe. I escaped the retirement home fight club. All is good in the world. And I wanted people to respect horse cops, all right? I used to not respect bike cops. And then that show Pacific Blue with A.C. Slater was on TV. So I respect bike cops now, and I assume it's going to be the same with the horse cops. And as far as Home Alone goes, you know, I'm going to throw blame out the window. If you look in that movie and you watch the pizza fight scene when they're spilling all the fight between Buzz and Kevin, you'll notice that Daddy McAllister goes to throw a bunch of napkins away into the trash can. If you see in the trash can, he accidentally throws Kevin's airline ticket in the trash can too. So how are they supposed to know that he's supposed to be at the airline when, you know, the adultish daughter counted, said he was going to be there, and the airline ticket's in the trash can, so they didn't know to look for it. That's my two cents. Stay safe, guys. Stay away from retirement homes. Respect your elders.
Wow. Ian.
Preach.
Covering another story we didn't even notice. So in Home Alone...
In the trash can.
The dad throws away the passport and Kevin's ticket.
It's not cool.
So
dad is bad.
Dad is a bad father. Yeah. And that's pretty expensive because now he's got to get a new passport for Kevin.
Well, apparently all the memes out there were like, he's rich anyway. He lives in that 20-bedroom house. He can afford to send anybody to Paris anyway, so he can afford it. He's got enough miles on his credit card.
What's he doing flying the whole family out to France?
Right, exactly.
For Christmas.
He can afford another child seat.
Yeah. And then I forgot to mention the last recap. We were talking about horse cops for some reason. Not cocks. not horse cocks. Horse cops. Horse police. Police on horses.
Gotcha.
Horse it's police just, that ride horses.
It's just hard to take you serious also because you got a pink microphone in front of you.
Oh, man. That's a Dan and Cody staple, man. Okay. No, but I was telling Cody, like, there's no reason for a horse cop.
Yes.
They're only there to intimidate.
Right.
They're not there to actually... Cody was talking
take pictures.
Yeah.
In Venice Beach, I see him down there. It's like, hey, let's get a selfie. The Instagram models are down there. I want to get a picture with the horse.
And vantage point. Yeah. Like, you're higher up, so you can see a distance going back.
Get and stilts if you want a vantage point.
I was talking to my boy Ronnie at work about this, too, and he brought up that this is a police tactic from adopted from, like, slavery time.
Mm.
With, like... slave owners riding around on horses, patrolling. Like,
take it there.
Yeah, it makes you feel less. And it makes you want, like to be in line. It's a crowd. It's like a barrier.
Right.
No one's going to, like, run through a horse.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So it's a way to, like, crowd control and, like, keep people out of the area.
Yep.
That horse takes a dump. No one's going to want to hang out over there.
Not at all.
But... they're definitely not for cops to, like, ride fast, like, freaking the Lone Ranger.
And they're going to skid. Those horses are going to skid. They don't have traction on those, like, metal hoofs.
Hell
they have
no
traction. There's no Michelin tire on there.
No. Cody, you're absolutely wrong. I'm standing by my horse cop stance there, buddy. So that was last week's episode. Check it out. Episode 195. If you like it. Listen, if you have stuff to say about this podcast, do the same thing. Hit us up on Instagram, hit the message button, and then hit the microphone in the message button. Leave us a message, and we'll play it on the next podcast.
It's not too complicated.
No, it's just 10 steps.
I know. I got to do better at that. I should hit you guys up more myself. I'm sorry. I would listen to you guys all the time when I'm an avid dog walker in the morning, so... I listen to the podcast and I'm walking my dog, so I don't know how many other dog walkers we have out there right now. Respect to those guys walking the dog or the baby.
Respect dog walkers and babies.
Yeah.
dog baby walkers.
It's the best time to podcast, man. Just pop it in there. You walk for about an hour.
I do podcasts on long runs.
Okay. I can't do that. I'm more music because the music pumps you up. Podcasts, you got to listen.
But if you're going if you're going more than 5 miles or something, you're probably running, you're definitely running faster miles than me. But out 6 miles take me over an hour. So
I run for about an hour.
Build up.
Which I'm very proud of you for running as well. I ran in college at Frostburg, and Dan wasn't much of a runner, but now you are, man. You're running more than me just about.
I watched you finish the LA Marathon. You were the inception of my runningness.
I had a breakdown after that marathon. It was my first marathon I ran at a legitimate pace, and I finished in 3 hours and 30 minutes. And
that's incredible.
My whole body couldn't stop shaking. My core temperature just dropped. I'd never experienced anything like that before in my life. And of all the road races I've done, 5Ks, 10Ks,
it was that
my body just shut down.
Well, you were running
26.
You're running professional pace, man.
Not professional. Professional pace is 5 minute miles, those guys do. I mean, I'm running, it's about average, above average.
Under four, I would say, is great.
Okay.
That's a great runner.
Okay.
Not like a career pro runner, but someone who is at these things to ball out.
Right. Finishing top 10% of your age group or something like that. Right.
That's amazing, dude. Yeah. And freaking, I heard that only less than 5% of all human beings will run a marathon.
Mm. It's a big task.
Or 0.5.
Yeah, I understand that. I still want to do a triathlon. But also, props to Kody. I mean, I listened to that one podcast where basically he pissed himself after a workout. Remember that? He worked out so hard that he sat down in the chair at the gym or something and pissed himself and passed out.
And he passed out and pissed himself.
That's my goal in life, to work out that hard. My wife can attest to that. I love being sore. No joke. When I'm sore, I know I'm doing good.
Yeah, you did it. You did it right.
And
but when you pass out at the gym and then urinate yourself, you have a fucking problem.
No, he doesn't have a problem. He's just, he's got goals he's trying to reach. He's hitting it.
The more I know Kody, the more I know that he needs help at working out.
Oh yeah, he doesn't do it properly.
I don't think he knows how to do it.
Gotcha.
I don't think he knows how to do it right. He goes too high. He goes too hard.
Yeah.
The thing about Kody Frederick, and I'm not talking shit about you, Kody. I love you.
He's not here to defend himself right now.
He will tell you this too. Yeah. I'm sure he will. Kody is a passionate man. Anything he does it to the fullest. Kody, last year, Kody did our Christmas cards. No, the year before that, Kody did our Christmas cards. Mm-hmm. He did them last year too, but I'm talking about the year before last year. He did our Christmas cards, right? And we were like, yeah, we just want to get something in front of the tree. Maybe Moxie ties us up with the Christmas lights and we're like hostage. Easy, right? How long you think that'll take? Half hour tops, right? No. Kody comes in here with fucking lights, comes in here with tripods, testing light shit and positioning us and we had to move the background over. Mm-hmm. The man is a passionate perfectionist. That's what I'm calling him. Kody Frederick, the passionate perfectionist.
And an intellectual, too.
He is. He's an intellectual. But
maybe that's why he doesn't know how to work out. He's an intellectual guy, but he's got to lift them weights.
Right. But if he's going to lift weights, he's going to lift weights.
Ooh.
Until he passes the fuck out.
Yes.
You got to chill, homie. You need to relax. Rest days. Don't go. When you're doing those distance runs, you got to leave some in the tank. That's part of the whole game, right? No?
You should end also, since I train, you do what's called striders at the end. So you should do maybe 5 100-meter quick sprints. All out, ball out sprints, but 80%, just to stretch out the legs, mix it up a little bit, get those fast twitch muscles going.
Right, right.
Yeah.
But I feel like, More so than anything else, the training is about learning how to conserve over a long period of time.
Right.
And you're like, all right, I'm gonna give it this.
You build yourself up. You build your muscle memory or something. You just build it up over the time, right?
Yeah. You're never gonna sprint a marathon.
Correct.
Yeah.
Props to Kody though.
Yeah. Props. We love you, Kody. Okay, so it's Christmas time.
Oh my gosh, yes.
Tis the season, man.
I feel it. You feel it?
I feel it, but I always feel it because I make myself feel it. Like I'm constantly watching the movies, Christmas movies.
Yeah.
I stop listening to podcasts basically, and I've got Christmas music on in my car, on Spotify at work. Mm-hmm. I wanted to talk about our favorite Christmas movies from the past, a classic, like one you grew up with,
right.
And then like a classic, and then like a current Christmas
movie. Right, like a Three Little Bears kind of deal. Three Little Bears, you know what I mean? Just give me three good ones.
Like an old one,
new right. one, and you know, one of the past.
Yeah.
Future.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Just like the Three Little Bears. Just like that, yeah. So do you want to go first?
I'll let you go first.
Okay. So I will say that my favorite
classic
Christmas movie.
Okay. Drum roll. Do we need a drum roll?
Sure. You want to provide that? Miracle on 34th Street.
Oh, that is a good classic. Now, what's that about, Dan?
That one is about a little girl who doesn't believe a goddamn thing about Santa Claus. And then...
Why's it got to be GD?
I don't know. She's very passionate about not giving a damn. Okay.
It's Christmas. You're not supposed to say GD.
Oh,
I mean,
damn, sorry.
It's about, man. You know, the birth of Jesus Christ, who is God's only son, right?
Right.
So don't... All right.
But if she doesn't give, all right, apologies. She doesn't care much for Christmas or Santa. She just doesn't believe in Santa Claus. Then this, like, it's the Macy's Day Parade. The runner of that parade meets a drunk Santa. Like, they hired this Santa who's like just drunk as hell. So they can't put him on. This random dude is there, like trying to teach him how to like crack a whip, and they're like, "Why don't you just get on there? You got a beard." And then they come to find out this guy is saying he's Santa Claus, and then they're like, "Do you want a job like being Santa at the mall?" And he's like, "Sure." So he kills it at the mall. The kids love him. This Dutch girl shows up. She doesn't speak a lick of English, and this Santa starts singing her Dutch songs. And they're like, holy shit, this guy's for real. Then another kid, he asked for like this fire engine. And they're like, the mom is like, they don't have the fire engine. I'm not going to be able to buy him the fire engine. Don't tell him I'm getting him a fire engine. And Santa's like, you're going to get your fire engine. And then he tells the mom they have him over at this other store. And then she freaks out. She goes to the manager of Macy's and she's like, oh my God. I love what you're doing here with this guy, sending people to other stores. It's a great message. It's a great thing. Mr. Macy like picks up on it and he's like, that's what we're going to do. So now he's making the company more money. They love him. Then something happens where like he hits this guy with his cane and they want to send him into the loony bin because he keeps saying he's Kris Kringle and now he's being violent. So, but then there's a big switch in the movie, which I love. Is that most of the rest of the movie is a court case. It's like Law and Order,
right.
Special Christmas Unit, and they're going back and forth like trying to prove that this guy's Santa Claus. It's very fun. It's very creative. And then there's a special miracle on 34th Street at the end of it. You should watch it. And
I was going to say, you make me want to watch it, Dan.
It's so good, dude. And the guy who plays Kris Kringle in it, I looked it up. He won an Oscar for... supporting actor. And I bet you, without doing any research, that's probably one of the only Oscars awarded to a person portraying Santa Claus.
Mm.
Or even a Christmas... Like, when's the last time a Christmas movie was nominated for an Oscar? Like, never, probably. Right?
It's been a while.
It's been a while.
Maybe, yeah. White Christmas, maybe with Bing Crosby, maybe. You know, that's got some star power. And plus, they had that hit song... You know.
Oh yeah, I'm dreaming.
Yeah, they gave us that song.
I never. I don't think I've seen White Christmas. or It's a Wonderful Life.
That's a shame.
I know.
That's,
you know, there's movies out there where you're like, I've
that's why
never
you are
it.
Who you are, Dan, because you, you know, you've never seen those movies.
That's what I'm saying. GD all the time. If I watch White Christmas, that'll change it.
Yes, you know, more mild tempered. You'd be saying, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, wearing a suit all the time, wearing a top hat.
I just got to watch White Christmas.
Yeah, exactly.
What do you have a
yeah,
favorite classic?
Yeah, I'm going to go with animation, though. I'm going to go Frosty the Snowman, 1969.
Okay.
You know, that comes on ABC channel, you know, that and Rudolph's Christmas, you know, the animation one.
Yep, yep.
Those are my classics. I mean, you can't go wrong with those. Those are timeless.
They're strange, though.
Well, now, yeah, because of the digital times we have now, but but I mean, there's something about it. I guess maybe our children will think it's super creepy.
Yeah,
I guess you're already thinking it's creepy, but I'm not.
I'm finding now that the stuff that I like and try to show her, she doesn't care. She doesn't give a shit. I tried to put on Mr. Rogers for her, and she was like, "No."
Maybe she's still too young for that, though, right?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. But and I feel like the new animation, like their eyes,
oh my gosh,
are just so used to like 4K and.
No, I thought you were gonna say the eyes of the characters, like the Frozen. I just saw Frozen 2. Their eyes are like 90% of their head.
Yeah,
it's like, oh my gosh, this is how realistic
that
is that.
That's
why are your eyes
true.
So big, Disney? You know, it's like, come on, you be realistic here.
Yeah, and why are you so sexy, Elsa? I mean, damn.
Yeah, she did change her hair up. I noticed that.
It's rumored that Elsa is a lesbian. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but I wish they would just like get to it. I thought she was gonna find a man in this one.
Yeah, Queen finds her ice man.
Right,
Iceman.
She doesn't need an ice man, I guess.
Yeah,
she's just into the unknown.
She's still figuring herself out, you know. She's not comfortable with who she is yet.
Yeah.
The other girl,
Anna,
she knows who she is.
Yeah.
That's what.
Yep.
Frozen 3. We'll see what happens.
So you've got Frosty the Snowman.
Yeah. Come on.
It's
now.
A good one.
Right?
It's good.
Are you feeling the pressure too, though? The short Christmas this year after Thanksgiving, people are saying that there's been a bit of a Christmas rush going on because Thanksgiving was so late.
I mean, yeah, I do feel it. I feel like
I see Christmas cards sitting there still.
I know they're not out. They're not out, and I'm not helping. Jenny knows there are things that like I'm just not going to do.
Yeah,
like take part in.
She knows your role,
and I know I feel terrible about it, but I don't. That much,
yeah.
Because I don't want to do it.
So you bought them, you paid for them, you deal with it.
Yeah, she has better handwriting than me.
Yeah.
If I wrote out all those cards, they would look terrible.
Same with Rebecca. I let her handle that. I was like, you know, if you're gonna buy them, you want to deal with that. I mean, we got a kid right now; it's busy time. If you want to effort that, go for it.
I'll take the picture.
Yeah.
I picked the picture.
Oh, there you go.
I did my input on that. You know.
He says the male doesn't do much in the family.
Exactly. I'm doing something. I got the tree.
Ah,
yeah. Because of Christmas coming so late. Well, like the start of it. Because of Thanksgiving being so late. I was really adamant about like, all right, 12-1. We gotta have like we gotta get the tree up, or it's not. It's just not gonna go up.
It's true. That's a short time. That's what they were saying.
You gotta like crack it. Crack out the.
And we're rocking a real tree too, right?
Oh yeah. Can't do a fakie.
Ooh, now we have some. I'm drawing some line right now. I just purchased my first artificial tree this year, Dan.
Oh, no.
So what else you got to say about the artificial tree first?
You can't,
man. I should have held off on saying that.
They look good?
Tell me about it, Dan.
The artificial tree, I will give you this. They look great, right? You don't have to go out and spend $60-$70 on a tree every year. I will say that. But the smell. You got to have the smell. You can't have Christmas without the smell of the tree. You need the tree. It's about finding. I don't go to like the farms or anything. I'm not nuts.
Depot.
Yeah, I'm going to Lowe's.
Yep.
You know.
All right, so that's your experience. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm letting you. Let me you finish. Go
you
ahead.
Tie it on the roof.
Tie it on the roof.
You know.
You feel like a man.
Yeah. You get it home. This one I just threw in my back seat and just rolled down the window. I was like, because I was alone, so I was like, I'm not fucking with this. But yeah, it's something about having a real tree. We always had a real tree when I was a kid.
All right.
But
I can respect that.
My mom started, she bought an artificial one.
Yeah.
But it's just like, it looks too perfect.
It looks too perfect. You decorate the thing with lights and ornaments anyway. It's all cut. You're only seeing like 10% of the tree anyway.
But you need like some imperfections on it.
Well, you know, you can bend the artificial tree leaves.
Right.
You know, you can bend that. The branches. You can bend it.
And the fur on an artificial, I feel like they could do better.
The technology now, I just did my research. So I'm ready. I got some firepower to fight you on this one.
The fiber optic.
I did not go fiber optic because of this. I'm aware that the lights will eventually burn out or there might be a glitch. So I went with a unlit, real feel Douglas fir tree. It's called Real Feel.
And let me Google this.
So it's no longer, my parents, we had an artificial tree growing up, but we mixed it up. It was like every other year we do real fake. But our artificial tree had, it was like fake needles. This one I just got delivered from Home Depot was legitimate, like real
delivered
feel.
You didn't delivered. Even go get it?
Actually, I did go get it. I had the option. It could be delivered to the house or I could go and pick it up. But I'll tell you what I did do. It was kind of funny still. So they're selling the real trees out there, and this is what I do every year though, is I'll go to the tree scraps from people that buy the real trees, and I'll use that as decor around the house. So I'll still have the chopped off branches in the house. So that also provides a real smell.
There's your smell.
There's my smell, but also candles, Dan. And what wife, girlfriend doesn't love a candle? So Rebecca's got like 10 candles lit around the house. I'm not going to smell that tree anyway. I'm not going to smell it. So I'm pushing for eventually this tree, you know, will pay itself off in like 3 years. Also, you know, you're saving the environment in a way, and tree prices have gone way up. It's crazy. If you do, there's an article about like how it's going up like $20.
Damn. So you can get a Dunhill fir tree with clear lights.
Are you looking at the lit
trees? 185. Yeah, I wouldn't want one.
I spent around like $250 for it.
Yeah, so just like in that. A couple Christmases, you're good.
Yep. Now of course you have to store it, and thankfully we have a garage right now. But who knows our future situation? We are renting, but you know, you hope to have enough room for it. But that's a good debate though to talk about if you want a real tree or a fake tree. And I'm for both.
It does look hell.
But you can manipulate the branches. So you can, if you want to have a gap in it, man, feel free to have a gap in it.
Well, damn. My biggest argument was the needles. I want it to feel like the needles of like that tree.
And I have a real feel. It feels real. It's a plastic, you know, it's like a composite hard plastic or something. But I mean, it does really, it is sharp. It, you know, when you tap it, you know, it pricks, you know.
But do you know in your heart that it's fake?
You know, after a few Christmas cocktails, Dan, I feel it in my heart, you know?
You're like, what? You just pour some honey on it?
No, some eggnog.
Get that sap feel.
Yeah, see? Now we're getting into it.
Stick a squirrel in there. All right.
Style. So for everybody at home, I do appreciate the real tree, but also I have appreciation also for the artificial.
Middle of the road, like growing up,
yes.
Christmas movie.
All right.
For me, this is like, whew. It's hard, man. I watch so many Christmas movies that I love, and I have so many categories of like.
And this is before Hallmark came out with all their spin-offs.
I should have even added like a dumb Christmas movie that you always have to watch.
What should
like
be?
You know it's dumb, but you have to watch it.
Right. It should be Wonderful Life. I mean, that's the one that's a kind of dumb one you watch. Yeah.
My growing up. One that I have to watch every single year is, and it's probably my all-time favorite Christmas movie, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
Okay.
Have to watch.
But how old were you when that came out? Because I feel like that was a bit of,
man.
I feel like we were too young for that.
So, 89. Hour and 37 minutes. That's not a long movie in this. So,
89, we were pretty much in middle school.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's like, you know. 6th, 7th, 8th grade, that kind of humor, I feel like. Anyway, for me.
I think I was able to watch it.
Yeah, for you maybe. You had an older sister too. So.
Yeah, and older brother.
Older brother, that's right.
Yeah, I probably watched it a little too young at first, but it's still a fun Christmas movie.
It's really set in.
Like the snot, the dog.
Oh
and,
my gosh.
Oh, it's just amazing. It's amazing.
The sled rocket freaking just being like.
The sled rocket, the old granny and and Grandpa Randy Quaid.
And what guy can't relate to setting up Christmas lights on his house and just being so proud of it? Even as a, right. I was like 13 years old setting up the house or Christmas lights on my house at my mom's house, and I felt so proud every year doing it.
And you like marvel
yeah,
at them.
Yeah, it's so true. You know, and you plug it in, it works, and or you have like half of them out, you're like, son of a...
Yeah, mother F.
Yep, I get it.
That's the... For me, that's Christmas. That's yep. like the best.
Yep.
What about you?
For me, I remember getting this VHS tape for Christmas. You know, it was all about the VHS tapes, and I remember getting... Number one, of course, Home Alone. I don't want to go with the obvious, Home Alone.
Home Alone's great.
Home Alone is great. But the other one was Tim Allen's Santa Claus.
Yes!
You know? I think that's a good second. Home Alone obviously is in its own category, but, you know.
Tim Growing Allen, up.
Yeah, that was I was at the right age for that. We got the VHS tape. So happy to get it.
And that's a good spin on the Christmas
yeah.
movie.
Yeah.
Like, no one's ever done that.
Santa dies.
Yeah. Santa like, dies, like, the first... For one, what's great about that movie is, like, day one, I yeah. think it's Christmas, you know? Most Christmas movies are leading up to mm-hmm. Christmas. And then... But, so this is... This movie's, like, a year old. Like, a right. year goes by in this right. movie.
He's got to learn to be Santa.
Yeah.
Yep. And the shenanigans that take place with his son at home, and I think they're divorced, right?
Yeah, yeah, the parents that too. Yeah, parents are divorced.
That's ahead of its time too, in a way. They were tackling that issue of divorced families. You know?
Absolutely.
No other movies were doing that.
You get an inside look on. They made the elves like high tech.
Oh yeah.
With all the, yeah. the gear and jetpacks,
yeah.
and
they really modern Christmas, yeah.
Animatronic reindeer.
Yeah. Well, was that in Santa Claus 2? There was one that was like, it was completely, or three even. Jeez, they did so many spinoffs on
Dude,
that.
Dude, I love, I appreciate 2 and 3 okay. as well. Respect. Two, he needs Mrs. Claus.
Yeah.
He has to have Mrs. Claus. Mm-hmm. He has to be married or else he loses,
but he no loses offspring.
His Santa like, magic.
What, did they do any offspring? You know, it's kind of funny, you know, getting the details about that.
Right. And then 3 is just off the rails. Have you seen 3?
Is that the robot one?
The robot one yeah. and Jack Frost.
Jack Frost, yeah. Martin Short.
Martin Short comes yes. in. Yeah. What that's a fun one. This is very, very hard.
Now, what's current to you? What year are you, what's your line you're drawing the line at for current?
I don't even know. Like mid-2000s?
Okay. Okay. Or like okay.
Yeah, 2000s.
All right, we'll go with that then. I got some options.
You go first.
Elf. Got to be Elf. Right now.
When did that come out?
Elf was in, I'm trying to find out, 2003. I think that's a gem of a movie. Mm-hmm. I love the cheesy graphics at the North Pole while they're there, and he's got to go through the gumdrop candy cane land. I just watched it recently, so it's fresh Elf's in my great. Memory right now. And how excited he is. Will Ferrell just sells it because he's just huge and, you know, acts like a big kid. I mean, I feel like that way now.
he absolutely killed it in Elf. I feel like that movie mm-hmm. and Old School, when yeah. I think of Will Ferrell, like amazing movies, Elf and Old School for sure.
Yep.
And Jon Favreau directed that.
Yeah, Favreau is a multi-talented guy.
Yeah.
Side note about Favreau, sorry to get back on sports topics, but he's a co-owner of LAFC.
Boo.
LA Football Club, dancing LA Galaxy guy.
Yeah.
Battle for LA. And Favreau is always there, always cheering, always a big part of the game. So respect to that, respect to him.
I didn't realize he's that big a soccer fan.
You know, maybe it's a business deal. You wanted to get in the sports game.
Diversified.
Esports, man. I've done some esports things right now. Those things are huge, big money makers right yeah. now. Esports stuff, man.
All right. My current Christmas movie, I'm going with, you know what? I'm doing it. People don't like it.
Uh-huh.
4 Christmases.
All right.
You ever seen 4 Christmases?
No.
Man. I think Vince Vaughn absolutely kills it.
Is that where they go to each? They have 4 like.
It's Vince Vaughn and Reese Witherspoon.
Yes, I have seen this now. Okay,
and their parents are all divorced,
right?
So, and they hate Christmas. They are anti-Christmas. Mm-hmm. They're going to Fiji, for Christmas. They always pick like a big tropical place to go, and it ends up, they end up not being able to go due to the weather or whatever, and then they're on the news because they were going to go to Fiji, and like the news, they're covering the airport, trying to figure out, like, get the hot take on, like, oh, this airport's closed. What are you guys going to do? Blah, blah, blah. So once they're on the news, they start getting the phone calls from their family, like, oh, so you're going to be around for Christmas. So then they have to do 4 Christmases in a day.
You so
it's them going to each house, hitting each house, and seeing how fucked up each other's families are.
Exactly.
And
they're Vince, in it together.
Vince Vaughn is just like, I idolize Vince Vaughn as a comedian. He is so quick. His like, he's so natural at like his delivery of argumentative chatter. Like, some people hate it, but I love it.
And he's on Ritalin?
Yeah, and he's just like rambling. He's like, well, if I go to the house, then we got to go to the house. And then when we go to the house, are you gonna sit there? I don't like it when you sit there. I love it when you sit over here. Okay, so that's how we're gonna do this. Okay, great. I just love that.
Wish I could be some of that.
4 Christmases. You should see it.
I'm gonna rewatch it. I've watched it before. I'll definitely watch it again. The more of the adult Christmas movies, you got my mind spinning now. The Holiday. If I'm gonna do a non-traditional. That's with Jack Black and Cameron Diaz and Jude Law.
Do they like Kate Winslet? They like switch?
Yeah, like brother and sister in London and the UK, you know, between the UK and the United States or something like that. It's more of an adult Christmas movie, but I mean, I think that's a good little gem.
All right,
that was in 2006.
The terrible Christmas movie I have to watch.
That's funny. Yeah, I should say that. Yeah,
Holiday in Handcuffs. That's my jam.
All right, please explain that.
That's an ABC Family Christmas movie, I believe, starring Melissa Joan Hart and AC Slater, Mario Lopez, and she basically, Melissa Joan Hart gets dumped like the day before Christmas. So she like she like freaks out. She's got to bring a boyfriend to her parents' house for Christmas. So she straight up kidnaps Mario Lopez.
Yeah, yes.
With a gun.
Yep.
And she makes him be her boyfriend for the weekend at her parents' like log cabin or whatever.
Yes, that's right.
He has every option. Like, they make it as if this guy like cannot overpower everybody in this house or Melissa Joan Hart, but it's for whatever reason he always ends up having to stay, and but he could leave at any time he wants, but he doesn't, and it goes on. And
all right, be sure to on demand that.
Check it out.
Very nice. The Christmas Story is obviously a classic. I mean, we're trying to stay away from the classics kind of way, right? We're not.
Yeah,
I mean, we hit on some of them, but you know, it's a Christmas Story is a classic. Scrooge or Bill Murray, I love that one.
Scrooge is great.
Yeah, Bill Murray, man, what a gem. I learned a lot about him with that, making the movies that made us on Netflix about Ghostbusters. You know, they talk about a little bit about Bill Murray's personality and how he would show up the day before. Like, they didn't know if he was going to show up the set, you know.
Oh, because he was like Playboy Bill Murray.
Yeah, like nowadays you hear only good things about Bill Murray. He's playing frisbee with people and flag football. You're hearing all these great stories about him. I guess back in the day, he was just in demand, I guess.
You know? A hot head.
Yes.
Cool, man.
And the Grinch, you know, Jim Carrey. The animated one that just came out, I'm showing my son that. I mean, I've actually enjoyed that one. The new animated Grinch
came out
like last year. That's a good one.
I like that
myself.
One.
Lucy Liu or something her name is. Lucy... What's her name? The girl in the Grinch? The
Cindy Lou Who.
Cindy Lou Who. What is
Cindy Lou Who?
The animated one, man. She's a firecracker. You're not a Rams fan anymore, are you, Dan? When I first met Dan, he was the biggest sports fan, which is why I think we hit it off so well. And now Dan is like condemned sports for some reason.
No, I don't. Yeah, I don't condemn.
You hate the NFL.
I disagree with a lot of the NFL's policies and rules. Okay. I will say that. But I'm not, I won't just exclusively not watch it, you know?
You were all in RG3 at the time. You bought his jersey.
Oh, absolutely.
And then something went sideways, and you were like, the NFL is dead. And I was like, Dan, I work for the NFL Network, bro. What's up? And you're like, I can't talk to you anymore, man. I did not say that.
I will say I enjoy sports a lot more now that I'm more casually involved. Okay. You know?
Yeah.
Fantasy
football.
No, yeah. I don't do it. Being that involved and that invested in something I can't control is hard for me, you know? And you give it so much. Like, there were Sundays where, like, I'd go out.
Yeah.
And, like, I'm watching every game.
Yep.
I'm following on my phone.
Yep.
And, like, it's affecting my mood and life, you know?
And then he started running.
Yeah, I'm like, I can't let this thing like consume me like this anymore. Plus, it's expensive. And when we drop cable, it's harder to watch the games. You got to go to a bar.
Or like I was just talking about the antenna.
Right.
There's some other ways around. But you were what tattoos you have? I know you had the Wizards tattoo.
Oh yeah, I got a Wizards tattoo.
Is that the only sports tattoo you have?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and I have the DC landscape.
DC landscape. I remember the Wizards tattoo when I moved out here with Dan.
It's really bad.
And Dan was like, yeah, kiss the wizard. Kiss the wizard. And it's on his thigh. Yeah, Dan.
That was my rule. You got to kiss the wizard.
We'd be going out to Cabo Cantina where he used to work and stuff. And
yep.
Man, that was great. You guys really welcomed us out here in LA. I really appreciate that. You showed us the ropes.
Of course.
Santa Monica area. It was good.
We got to. We're Marylanders.
That's right.
Well, we were Marylanders. That's the other question.
Oh.
Is do you call this place home yet? Or are you like, I'm going to go back home to visit?
I do hate, my wife, Rebecca, hates when I say that. Yeah, I'm always like, I'm going to go home. It's like, I'm referring to Maryland. I'm going to fly back home. You know, she get that.
It's gone, man.
You know, for people back east that are listening to this, I have my mom, or whenever I fly back, I have her bring back a six-pack of Yingling for me. She bubble wraps it, puts it in the bag, brings back some Yingling. They don't have Yingling out here.
They don't.
Not out here. So, but I didn't realize too. Now they have cans.
Right.
I was always doing the bottles, which can break easier. I should just get the cans out here. Now.
Yeah, Yingling cans. You can get.
We got Jimmy's crabs, Jimmy Seafood. We got crab cakes coming out for Christmas.
Oh yeah.
But you know, our tried and true is the Box Hill crab cake up there in Aberdeen and Bel Air, Maryland. That's the one that
Brandon gets.
Yes.
Yeah.
Funny story with that. You know, he gets the same crab cakes we do. He got it from his aunt and uncle that lived near there, because Brandon didn't live near there at all.
Mm-mm.
So he had a relative that lived near there, and that's where I'm from. So that's crazy.
When we'd go back for Christmas to Maryland, we started this tradition with the Knights, Dave and Christine, and we go to their place, and they get crabs. So we have like a mini crab feast in December. Yeah.
But they're out of season.
In Frederick, they can just get them.
I think, you know, they...
And they're fucking big, man.
And they get them, I think, from Louisiana and Texas. So that's probably where they're getting them from. Yeah.
But I'm like, I don't care.
Yeah.
And this is my one trip to Maryland.
Now I'm going
to
eat.
I'm like,
let's feast.
Let's get these crabs
man. Let's cut some fingers. Let's bleed a little bit.
Absolutely.
Are you a mustard eater?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah, I'll eat it.
From day one, from you were a little lad?
I didn't care.
Wow.
And then I think it was too late. I was too late in the game when someone was like, you know that's their poop, Brett. And I'd be like, I don't give a fuck.
That's great.
I love that mustard.
That's great.
Yeah. Crabbies, man.
Yeah.
God bless
them. And I love how everyone's got their own way to open them, and it's a competition, and, you know, it's a social thing.
Yeah.
But I just recently learned, I didn't realize this, it was actually a poor man's food back in the day. Like it was...
Oh, of course.
Because they're bottom feeders, too. I mean, crabs eat all the stuff off the bottom of the floor.
Yeah.
You know?
It's broke food.
It's broke
crustaceans.
Food.
Crustaceans.
And now we're spending like, $800 just to ship them out of here to California.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy.
Yeah, it's like the same... It's on the same level as like a crawfish, I guess.
Yeah.
Or shrimp.
The things we do, though.
Shrimp's expensive, and that's a bottom feeder. Yeah, like a good like
shrimp.
A good
prawn.
Like tiger prawns.
Good prawn.
Right. Scrimps. Good old scrimps. Here's a story. High school coach under fire for taking team to Hooters following a loss.
What a gem. What a guy. What sport?
Soccer.
Okay.
The coach.
JV or varsity?
It's a
junior. I love all the technicalities junior, like to justify it.
It's a junior / senior high school boys soccer team. They're under fire after taking.
I'm fine with it.
He's under fire taking the team out to dinner at Hooters following a 3-0 loss.
I'm fine with it. As long as it, you know, as long as the coach didn't drink beer, I'm fine with it.
It was the first loss of the season.
Yeah.
And the coach, Blake White, didn't want his players to dwell on losing in the sectional championship game. So he decided to celebrate their otherwise successful season by going to Hooters.
I'm happy. I'm fine with it.
What's wrong with that?
Nothing wrong. And I mean, you know, have you seen their advertising lately and their menu? I mean, it's really family friendly.
Hooters is family friendly?
Totally.
I'm not going that far.
Are you kidding me?
It's definitely not family friendly.
They have a kids menu.
Is that the definition of family friendly?
Yes. They have high chairs there, booster seats.
Come to Hooters. We have a kids menu.
And you know what, waitresses, you know, aren't wearing tight pants. And, you know, I mean, it's the same. You're not selling me on this as bad.
I don't think it's bad, but I don't think it's family friendly. Mm. The thing is,
on paper, okay, I understand that. Yes,
here's what the superintendent said.
It's like Applebee's, you know, right? Applebee's is obviously gonna be a family friendly place, right? I get that.
She said, the superintendent is a female. She said, I took this very seriously and addressed it immediately with the students and the individual. Lynn Rutnick, superintendent of Lake George Central School District, said.
What state? Lake George. That's
not sure.
Lake New York?
George.
It also depends, you know, all these technicalities on whether it's justifiable is funny.
Trisha Biles, president of the school board, said, corrective action is being taken against White.
She just has to say this stuff.
Yeah.
She totally has to say this stuff.
She didn't elaborate on what the school is doing to punish White or if any of the players.
Because he's not being punished. It's just like, I'm going to talk to the media. I'll tell them it was a bad choice and we'll just go about our way.
Right. Here's my thing. Like, all right, a Hooters waitress wears like a tank top, tights, and then booty shorts over the tights. These kids in high school are probably seeing more at high school.
Ooh, good point.
Than at Hooters.
Very good point.
You know?
Yep.
And sure, there's a novelty. It's called Hooters.
With an owl.
But there's a fucking owl on the shirt. They're covering their bases. It's not about the boobies.
It's about the wings.
It's about those wings. It's a hoot.
Yes.
I don't have a problem with this.
The only problem I have is the service with Hooters. Whenever I've gone there, it's been horrible. It's
terrible.
Yeah, because you know it has been. They gave me a warm beer mug before. Warm.
That's straight out the dishwasher.
I was like, come on.
What I don't like about Hooters wings is that they leave them connected. The flat part and the drumstick part, and they leave the little like wingy piece on.
I think
it looks too much like a wing. It freaks me out.
I had a friend that was super into this, and I think he did a lot of research on wing places, and he doesn't like how, I guess, Hooters nickels and dimes you on sauces or something.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so he did not sell me on Hooters wings.
And then you got high school kids.
Right.
Raging hormones. They probably...
Are they raging?
Yeah, I think. I guess mine were. Like, if I went to Hooters as a high schooler, I would be like, sweet, we're going to go see some titties, you know? I would be stoked for it. But I don't think that I would, like, there, I wouldn't act out, you know? I don't...
you're not going to act out.
Unless he was... Did he use school money?
Right.
For Hooters?
And what was the other option? I mean, were there other restaurants available at the time?
Exactly. Yeah. Who knows where this place was?
I'm not going to spend my, you know, county money on driving gas to go out of my way to an Applebee's when I can save the county money by driving.
Right.
Making stuff
up. Like, I got to go to Hooters.
Yeah, I'm saving you money here. I'm not going to drive out of my way.
I remember when I was on the soccer team in high school, we played like an out-of-county game, and it was late. And, I mean, this was 4 years of school. One time we stopped at a McDonald's.
Hmm.
And I don't know who paid for that, if it was the school or coach. But that's a lot of money if you're paying like a team of 15 to 20 kids.
We hope it's happy hour when you're going.
Right. Everybody gets one wing.
Or the happy hour. It's like half price apps, you know?
Yeah. So this is bad. One, if he spent school money on the Hooters.
Is that though? I don't think so.
Unless they had a budget for it, like, hey, get them dinner somewhere.
I mean, you know, you played high school sports, right? Or in college, at least, we were given a budget. Our coach would take us places, and typically there were all-you-can-eat buffets. You
right.
know? But I mean, you got budgets. Yeah, of course.
I don't know if you want to go to a Hooters in Frostburg.
There wasn't one. Maybe Cumberland down there.
So we're both in agreement on this one?
Yes.
Non-issue.
We're going to Hooters.
I know how much Rebecca loves Beyonce.
Yeah, she's a beehive.
So I had to drop a Jay and Beyonce news story here.
Oh, boy.
For her to listen to. And I want to see where your head's at on this one. So
I might have to comment later and call you in. Call it later.
All right. So Jay, Diddy had his 50th birthday. Okay.
Okay.
This is a big old party.
I'm guessing New York. Nightclub, I'm guessing. That's, you know, I'm drawing a picture here.
I think it was at his house.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm not going nowhere.
Yeah, when you're 50, you need a bed nearby.
That is hilarious.
You want to be in the comfort of your own home.
Yeah, that's good.
So, Diddy had his 50th birthday. Who's who of hip-hop culture, R&B, we're in attendance. Jay-Z and Beyonce were there. The music's going. Everyone's partying. And someone captured a video of Beyonce dancing with Kelly Rowland and another rapper, like just like in a group, like dancing around. And then there's this other guy off to the side, and he's got his phone out, and he appears to be like trying to like take video or like get like some sort of selfie with Beyonce in the frame. And Jay-Z sees this, and he snatches the phone out of the guy's hand and sort of scolds him. Now, this video is like surfaced on Twitter. I'm gonna play it for you right now,
all right.
So you can make a call on it.
There's a lot of people in this video.
I know this is Diddy's birthday. He's gonna have a bunch of people there. So there's Beyonce, there's Jay-Z. Did you see it? They're all just dancing, having a good time. Here, I'll replay it.
Oh, I saw it, but I'm waiting for the snatch. I was hoping he was going to get the snatch.
Boom.
Oh, that's a snatch. Got it.
He just took it.
One more time. Because I thought the video itself was him snatching. It's actually in the background.
So she's dancing. You see him scold him?
He's like, give me that phone. What you thinking,
man?
Yeah,
he's like, what the hell?
You're in our circle. You're here at this VIP party. We're all above that. I get it.
This might be a little longer video. So he's basically like, hey, man, stop trying to record my girl.
Yep. I respect that.
While she's dancing.
But at the same time, I guess, you know, for us, I mean, of course, we're going to want to get that video or selfie with her. But the people at that party, I feel like, are in that circle or in that world.
But he's at that party too.
Exactly. That's
the guy filming it. Is at that party too.
The guy should not be doing that. How did people get into this party is what I want to know.
You think Jay-Z had a right to grab that guy's phone?
Yeah, because to me, everybody at that party should have a purpose there. They all know somebody. It's not like a third cousin's, you know, aunt, you know, like friend of a friend of a friend. It should be an inner circle of people. So
it's not. You think because it's not like a public. You can buy tickets to this party. Everybody should be on there like, we're not fans taking pics with
people. Like when I'm on set, you know, with, you know, actors, you know, I'm not asking for selfies. I'm not asking for that stuff. It's like frowned upon. It's like, you know, you're not going to get asked back kind of thing. It should be the same thing in this world or this party. So how do you feel, Dan?
I don't know if Jay-Z has the right to touch that person's phone.
Oh, Dan.
You know, like from Jay-Z... billionaire, I think, you know, for him to physically snatch somebody's property like that, A, it's like, that's the guy's phone.
Dan, he's you changed the code here. When I met you, man, you know, bouncer at the club, Dan.
I'm at this party too, and I'm filming what's around me. So if he was just like this, snapping pictures of Beyonce, phone in her face, like paparazzi, I would be like, okay, it's cool to snatch his phone. But I, from the little clip that I see,
well, again, we need no more backstory. Like,
I feel like the guy is just holding his phone up, like, hey, oh yeah, and Beyonce's over here, and then he gets his phone taken by Jay-Z.
We got no more backstory. What's true with this guy? That he just happened to walk up in that dance circle. Does he know them?
Right. Because
he could have been like, that could be his cousin. He'd be like, yo, cuz, why are you doing that? You know, it's like.
Plus, how many people do you, they can't go anywhere without someone trying to take a picture of them.
Yeah.
This is a party. You should be used to it.
Yeah. And that's how, you know, athletes are the same way. I mean, they're used to being photographed. I mean, you'd be having a full-on conversation and people are taking photos and they're just in. They're in, you know, locked in mode. I mean, like, they're used to it. Yeah. Meanwhile, me, I'm like side-eyeing, like, what are these people doing? They're trained.
All right. I think it's time for this week's.
Are we doing the champion of the week thing?
Yeah.
I love when you and Cody do it. Much respect to Cody. So can I say it with
Let's
you?
Let's do it. Let's do
it. Okay.
I think it's time for this week's champion of the week.
The champion of the week. Yeah.
All right. So this week's champion, Aleem Chaudhry. He's a deli owner, and he's received more than 400 letters to Santa, and he's responded to all of them.
That's a champion to me.
In addition to Chaudhry being the owner of Gino's Stoppin' By Deli in San Antonio, Texas, he's also known for being a reliable messenger in Santa's workshop. Chaudhry gained a Yuletide reputation a few years back when he put up a bright red mailbox for the North Pole. Though,
what a guy.
What a guy. It was meant for just holiday decoration.
Aww.
But many local children started using the mailbox to drop off actual letters to Santa. So Chaudhry took it upon himself to write back to every letter. Last year alone, Chaudhry received and wrote back to more than 400 letters. And then they say not only is he planning to do the same thing this year, he's making it easier for the tots to write their notes to Saint Nick. That's insane.
That's so great.
When you have just a stupid little mailbox that you put up as decoration, and then kids start using it, and then you're like, man, I run this deli, but fuck it. Now I'm responding to letters from Santa? Crazy.
That is so perfect. That's what makes these Christmas stories, community stories, so great.
What I love about it is the Christmas magic that I was talking about in a couple podcasts ago. You can't, like, you got to put up, to keep Christmas magic alive, you got to do a bunch of stuff, you know? You got to play the game. You got to make Santa real. And the only way to make Santa real is to put in extra effort for the kids. So when these kids get a letter back from Santa,
it's real.
That reinforces the lie.
I was going to ask you about that, how you were growing up with Moxie here. Are you teaching her about Santa and all that?
Like, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. That's one of the funnest things about Christmas is seeing it through her eyes. And now that she's three, like, she's fully on board with Santa Claus, into the Elf on the Shelf. It's a fun time, you know? And I don't want to take that away from her. And I feel like it won't be a big letdown by the end of it. It'll just be like, that was a cool time. Cause that's how I feel about it now. I don't feel like it screwed me up.
Right.
What about you?
Well, you know, now that having a child myself, I'm kind of torn as what to do as well, you know? Mm-hmm. But one thing I did hear, I thought was pretty good. Someone posted online about, you know, have Santa give, I guess, the least expensive gifts or the smaller mm-hmm. gifts. You know, mm-hmm. let Santa know that, you know, you earned this, you know, like you bought this gift for them, like the Xbox or something more expensive.
Right.
None of my parents ever really did that. I'm trying to think if they said like my Sega Genesis was from them or Santa. I don't quite remember, but I do get the principle of it all.
And it's so that when they go to school or something, they're bragging about Santa brought me an Xbox.
Right.
And then
right,
some other kid's like, Santa brought me some pencils. What the hell, Santa?
Well, I get, okay, yeah, I get that. But, you know, yeah.
So that's why you make it the least expensive. Like, Santa brings the, you know, the okay gifts.
The okay gifts. And, you know, let your child know that, you know, you got them the best gift that they wanted and that you earned it, you know, you paid for it kind of thing, mm-hmm. I guess. There's some logic behind that I could not know.
Plus, parents want credit for that shit.
That's a, you know, yeah.
It's like, I got you that ping pong mm-hmm. table, not Santa. That's me.
Exactly. I have a little champion of the week, if you will.
Yeah.
I just came to light when you said that.
Second champion of the week. Run it back.
The champion of the week. Yeah.
I saw a news story that a bunch of community members were outside a children's hospital flashing lights.
What?
Yeah, and so all the kids in the hospital went outside and saw this and, you know, lit up their day a little bit.
Hell yeah.
And I think the same, your fraternity, SAE, at UCLA does the same thing.
Really?
Their fraternity house is outside of a hospital. Mm-hmm. And from what I've heard and what I've seen when I drive by, when I do games at UCLA, I've seen, you know, obviously the proximity of how close they are, but also the lights outside. So yeah. Props to SAE at UCLA.
Hell yeah. So they just decorated up for the kids to see?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome.
And I think the theme is, you know, maybe they do it once or twice a night or, you know, something like that. Mm-hmm. The kids know about it, that they're being cared for and people are thinking about them.
That's awesome.
That's a good champion.
Good champ. Good shit. All right, man. Well, I think that's the podcast right there.
My first podcast.
You're done, man. Wow. How do you feel?
Palms are sweaty.
You're on the
knees weak, arms spaghetti. I was nervous. I tried to get my notes down. I was like, Dan, text me what we're going to talk about. And it's my first time. It's been both therapeutic and entertaining.
It's fun, right?
Yeah, everyone should do a podcast.
You
it's
just
nice.
Get, you just air out whatever the hell you're thinking or talking about.
And I think the bottle of wine that is in front of me is about done, too. That helped a little bit, too.
Yeah. No, this is good stuff.
But props to you and the D&K podcast, man. You guys are doing a good thing. I enjoy listening to you guys. And, you know, I'm going to be calling in, hopefully, and responding back to some of these things.
Thanks, man.
Get back here again. Well, Merry Christmas to you, Dan.
Merry Christmas.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
2020. Crazy to think, dude.
2020. Me and Cody want to thank you all for listening every week. Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. Happy life. See you next year.